knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We just talked about the different types of plant cells, but now we need to understand how those cells organize themselves to form larger structures. First, let's review the levels of organization in living organisms. Cells are the building blocks of life, but cells are usually organized into tissues, and these tissues will often be organized into organs, and this is true of plants just as it is for animals. Plants have three main types of tissues, and all of these tissues are comprised of the plant cells we discussed in the previous tutorial. So let's go through these types of tissue now. First up, ground tissue makes up the majority of a plant's body, so to speak, and it's broken up into three subgroups based on cell type. Those are the parenchyma, the collenchyma, and the sclerenchyma, which we just learned about. Ground parenchyma tissue is the most common tissue in a plant. It appears in a variety of locations and does many jobs. Parenchyma tissue is responsible for the photosynthetic layer in leaves, called the mesophyll, where the plant performs gas exchange and creates sugars, making its own food. Parenchyma tissue is also how a plant stores excess energy in the form of starches, which are complex polysaccharides. Starch-filled parenchyma tissue can be found in a plant's roots, and parenchyma tissue also makes up the majority of a seed, so that the starches can feed the embryonic plant until it's able to photosynthesize on its own. Additionally, parenchyma tissue is so prevalent throughout a plant that it also takes on the role of growing to cover wounds and replace other tissues lost through physical trauma or disease. Wound closure is an important function for plants, just like it is for us, because if a plant has an open wound, then all sorts of pathogens, like fungi and bacteria, could invade the plant and quickly kill it. The other two subtypes of ground tissue, ground collenchyma tissue and ground sclerenchyma tissue, are also composed of cells by the same names. As we now know, both collenchyma cells and sclerenchyma cells have thick cell walls made of cellulose, and in some cases lignin, which provides structure for a plant. Therefore, ground collenchyma and ground sclerenchyma tissues can be found throughout a plant wherever structural support is most important. But as we said, ground tissues are just one of the three kinds of plant tissue, and these ground tissues are essentially sandwiched between the other two kinds of tissue in a plant. On the external surface of a plant, we can find dermal tissues. This name makes sense, because dermal is a word that relates to the skin or exterior of a living organism, so these tissues essentially form a sort of skin for the plant. A plant's skin is called the epidermis, and it's a layer of cells only one cell thick. Most of these cells don't have chloroplasts or other specialized organelles. They're primarily there just to serve as a protective layer to shield the more important tissues beneath. As extra protection, most epidermal tissues secrete a waxy substance called cuticle that prevents excess water from escaping the plant and also protects the plant from invasion by pathogens like fungi and bacteria. This cuticle is one of the main evolutionary advantages that land plants exhibit over their aquatic ancestors. Some epidermal cells can specialize to take on hair-like shapes, which help the plant with specific gas and nutrient transfer functions, but these hairs can also be useful in deterring insect herbivores that might try to graze on the plant. A plant also needs some openings in the epidermis in order to let water and gases travel in and out so as to maximize the surface area available for material exchange. These openings are called stomata. However, if they were left open all the time, then pathogens could infiltrate the plant through these areas. Therefore, some specialized epidermal cells, called guard cells, are utilized to cover the stomata. These curved cells appear in pairs on either side of a stoma and work together to open or close the stoma as needed by the plant. The function of guard cells is especially important for plants living in very dry areas that need to keep water from evaporating away during the day, so the stomata will often remain closed until the sun goes down. You can see this happen in warm season grasses and other plants growing in arid environments. In older sections of a plant that aren't growing as fast, the epidermis may transition into a thicker layer of cells called the periderm, which is the semi-permeable layer of the bark, where bark is a word that refers to all the tissues outside the vascular cambium. The periderm produces and is then protected by the rhizodome, which is the outermost layer and most familiar part of bark, since it's the layer covering the trunks of trees, which everyone can immediately see. The rhizodome protects the inner layers of the plant and is composed primarily of dead cells. It becomes especially well developed in the older stems and roots of trees. The final group of plant tissues is not actually present in all kinds of plants. Vascular tissues are the main characteristic that separates vascular plants, like trees, from non-vascular plants, like mosses, and it allows vascular plants to have a wider variety of growth strategies. Vascular tissue is important for large plants like shrubs and trees because it redistributes water and nutrients throughout a plant's body, allowing for trees to grow tall without losing the capacity for nutrient transport between distantly separated parts, like the branches and the roots. Vascular tissue is what allowed the ancestors of modern plants to abandon their reliance on living in or near water sources, meaning that we can now find plants in almost every environment on Earth, regardless of how dry they seem. We will discuss these aspects of plant evolution a bit later in the series. Vascular tissue can be further broken down into two types: xylem and phloem. Xylem is a vascular tissue made of dead cells called tracheids and vessel elements. These are both elongated cells whose walls are strengthened with lignin, the substance that makes woody plants so stiff and strong. Xylem is the vascular tissue responsible for transporting water and mineral nutrients upwards. The roots of a plant absorb water and minerals from the soil. This water is brought to the center of the root, where it encounters the xylem. Within the xylem, there are two kinds of transport tubes, composed of the tracheids and vessel elements we just mentioned. Tracheids are smaller and tapered at each end, while the vessels consist of cells lined up to create open tubes, which are also called xylem conduits. These conduits are around the width of a human hair and can be extremely long. Water is transported in a passive manner through the plant by pressure and chemical potential gradients. Specifically, this movement is driven primarily by potential differences in water caused by the negative pressure differential generated by the evaporation of water from the leaves. This process is known as the cohesion tension mechanism, or CT mechanism. Essentially, the water is initially pulled up through the xylem due to the cohesive and adhesive properties of water, in this case referred to as capillary action, which we discussed in the general chemistry series. But as the plant grows, there is never a break in the water column within the plant. As water evaporates from the leaves, it draws the water column upwards against gravity, causing tension. This process, which is responsible for the tension part of the CT mechanism, is known as transpiration, and it occurs when water evaporates from a plant's leaves into the air. So the mechanism of transpiration and the resulting surface tension at the stomatal openings pulls water molecules upwards to replace those lost by evaporation. This force is transferred through the plant's water columns down to its roots, where it causes more water to be pulled in from the soil. This continuous water transportation pathway is known as the soil-plant-atmosphere continuum. So that covers the xylem. The other kind of vascular tissue we mentioned is phloem, and it's composed of living cells called companion cells and sieve cells. Companion cells regulate the function of the phloem, while the sieve cells execute this function. Phloem tissue is responsible for transporting the sugars produced through photosynthesis in the leaves to all of the other parts of the plant. Sieve cells are connected by sieve plates, which are membranes with pores through which the sugar solution can pass. The movement of this sugary sap through the phloem is caused by positive hydrostatic pressure. This process is called translocation, and it is driven primarily by phloem interacting with specialized cells to load and unload the sap. To be more specific, cells in the leaves, which are capable of photosynthesis, act as a sugar source, and can thereby load the sieve cells of the phloem by transporting sugar molecules into them. This causes some of the water from the xylem to passively enter the sieve by osmosis, thereby thinning the sap and creating pressure, which pushes the sap through the sieve plate pores and down the tube. This will eventually make it to other cells, which we can consider sugar sinks. These are the cells the plants use to store sugars, like the roots, as well as fruits, if present. Here, cells actively transport solutes out of the sieve, producing the precise opposite effect as with the sugar source. This concentration gradient for the sugar, from source to sink, is what manifests the pressure flow through the sieve tube, and thereby the movement of sap through phloem. In this way, xylem and phloem vessels act sort of like the arteries and veins that comprise the circulatory system in our bodies, in that they shuttle important substances around so that they can be made available to all the cells in the organism. So that covers the three types of plant tissues, those being ground tissue, with its three subtypes, parenchyma, collenchyma, and sclerenchyma, dermal tissue, and vascular tissue, which can be divided into xylem and phloem. Now that we know the different kinds of cells in a plant and how they group together to form different tissues, it's time to see how those tissues form the different organs or parts of a plant.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.